morning.
Good morning.
My name is Andrew Ronholt. I am a student at Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary studying to be a pastor, and it's my great privilege and joy to gather here today with you around the means of grace in both word and sacrament. We'll follow the order of service according to setting one in the hymnal, or it's up on the screen. We'll begin with our opening hymn, hymn number 797.
Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways by
God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God now and forever.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Say is worthwhile, not worthless, you will be my spokesman. They must turn to you, but you must not turn to them. I will make you like a bronze wall to this people. They will fight against you, but they will not overcome you. Because I am with you to save you and to rescue you, declares the Lord. I will rescue you from the hand of the wicked, and I will deliver you from the grasp of the ruthless. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll continue with Psalm 31E, which is found on page 158 in the Gray Psalter. Because who hopes for what he already sees?
But if we hope for something we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with patient endurance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Alleluia. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Alleluia. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "May you receive mercy, Lord. This will never happen to you." But Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a snare to me because you are not thinking of the things of God, but the things of men." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone wants to follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, follow me. In fact, whoever wants to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. After all, what will it benefit a person if he gains the whole world but forfeits his soul? Or what can a person give in exchange for his soul?" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. We continue with the hymn of the day, hymn 867.
Thank you.
text for this week is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 25 through 30. We read, "At that time, Jesus continued, 'I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from clever and learned people and have revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, because this was pleasing to you. Everything has been entrusted to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wants to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, because I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.'" Dear fellow redeemed, there is peace and serenity in the air, a calmness that almost can't be described, just perfect. And then every morning it's always shattered by that oh so familiar sound of that alarm clock going off and ripping you away from your precious sleep. So what do? You roll out of bed, you groan, and you try to start your day. And pretty soon, your day has you reaching for perhaps a sugary sweet energy drink or a nice hot cup of coffee, anything that can give you the energy to make it to the end of the day. But we all know those things wear off, and then you're left sitting there, more tired than you think you've ever felt. The only thing that can occupy your mind now is the thoughts of your head hitting that pillow at night to give you a brief moment of relief from the weariness you've been feeling. But that's the problem, isn't it? That relief is brief, and you know the next morning you're going to have to start the whole process over again. You feel like an ox with a yoke placed upon you, toiling in the sun, wanting rest, but only having weariness. Yes, we as humans, we need rest. We more than crave it, we need it. We need physical rest, we need emotional rest. Most importantly, we need spiritual rest. And spiritual rest is what we find. True rest we find is not in the yoke of sin we were once in, but in the yoke of Christ we are in now. So as we take a look at our text for today, we note these disciples themselves, they were in great need of both physical and spiritual rest. They'd been traveling around with Jesus as he taught in Galilee. They had been working long hours, and more than that, they were starting to see the effects of the rejection Jewish leaders. John the Baptist had been arrested and put in prison. They had seen Christ denounce all these towns that had rejected him. The disciples were spiritually weary. They didn't know where to turn, and Jesus knew this. This is why Jesus spoke these words in our sermon text to his disciples. And the reason that these words echo so well in our minds, why they are so applicable to us here today, just like the disciples back then, as we go through the same things. Now, obviously, our stories are much different than the men who followed Jesus, but we're sinful men and women just like those disciples. And being sinful, we are subject to the weight of this sinful, broken world that weighs down. Our sinful nature makes us weary as we worry about every single little facet in life, wondering where we can find relief, where we can find hope, where we can find trust. Now, I'd like to focus on a key word that Jesus uses towards the end of the text that I think creates a good image for us of this weight. He uses the word yoke, this wooden beam that holds two oxen together that they can tow a heavy plow behind them as they work. Yes, Christ says, "Take up my yoke and follow me,"
Now, he does not mention a yoke of sin, but as he mentions his yoke, we must wonder which yoke did we bear before Christ's intervention. This yoke of sin, this weight of the world that weighed on our hearts and on our souls, spiritually exhausted us to the point of spiritual death. That yoke was beyond anything we could ever bear. So it left us in a spiritually dead state. And we still see the effects in our lives today. How do we try to carry the weight of the world and the weight of our own sin and guilt? We might look at our neighbor and say, well, doing a lot better than that guy is. That makes us feel a little bit better about ourselves and a little bit better about our spiritual condition. But kind of like the cup of coffee in the morning when you're tired, this is just a temporary fix. It's a band-aid that can't stop the bleeding. And so the weight of the world weighs back down on us. The weight of our sins continues to crush us. Now, the Pharisees in Jesus' day, these religious leaders that had been persecuting him and the disciples after they rejected him, they thought that the spiritual problems, the spiritual weight of sin could be solved through human effort. And that is why Christ speaks the words that he speaks in verses 25 through 27, where he talks about any time we try to deal with these on our own, we isolate ourselves. We isolate ourselves from God. He says in the text, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the clever and learned people and have revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, because this was pleasing to you. So the Pharisees thought they had come up with a solution, but they were left in the yoke of sin. But we, though we had that yoke of sin pressing down on us, that wasn't the end of our story. No, when our true spiritual rest was needed, true rest we found. We found because of our Savior's intervention, because of our Savior's call. He removed us from that yoke of sin, and we are now in the yoke of Christ. Christ offers the solution to all our spiritual problems with these simple words in our text. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Jesus offered a gracious opportunity to those disciples that followed him. They got to witness firsthand the miracles of Christ, the healing of Christ, the teaching of Christ. And most importantly, he brought those disciples to the foot of the cross so they could witness his death in their place for the penalty they should have paid. And most importantly, witness his victorious resurrection, proclaiming his victory over death. Now, Jesus offers that same invitation to each and every one of you. You see, he calls us away from that yoke of sin. And now, this exchange, when we really look at it, it is the most unfair exchange that has ever taken place in history. We deserve nothing but to carry that yoke of sin that we have built for ourselves. But Christ took that. He gave us his yoke. It was completely unfair in the greatest way possible. And God reveals this knowledge, God reveals this wonderful trait to us that we might have peace. He reveals it in a way that kind of goes against human intuition. This is not something that can only be grasped by the most influential and most powerful people in the world. No. This great trait was given to you and to me. It was given so that even a little child can understand it in simple words. Jesus loves me. Yes, Christ traded us a yoke of life for our yoke of death. He traded us a yoke of freedom for our yoke of slavery. So now that we have been freed, what does that yoke look like? We see that word yoke and we figure it will just be as toilsome as the work we had when we were trying to fight our way out from under the effects of sin. But nothing could be further from the truth. No, we know what the work in the new yoke of Christ is because we know the one who gave it to us. Christ simply says, I am gentle and humble in heart. He promises rest, that thing that we've been searching for. We didn't even know how much we needed it, but Christ delivered it to us. Now that is not to say we will not experience troubles in this life. The world will continue to attack you spiritually, but it cannot overcome you. This is where that picture of the yoke comes in. You are yoked to Christ. Christ is not going to let go of you. He has you. The humble master will never forsake you. He will never leave you because he loved you. He's loved you since before you were ever born. And what a beautiful mystery that has been revealed to you. Now, dear Christian, we know what it means to be tired, both physically and spiritually, in our old life of sin. But we now know the thrill, the true thrill of knowing we have rest in Christ. But how many people are walking around in your lives? They only know that yoke of sin that weighs heavily on their hearts and their minds. They are looking for some relief. Go and tell them this message. Go and tell them the gracious call of their Savior as he wants them to come to the foot of the cross and shatter that yoke of sin and take up his wonderful yoke. Go and tell them that message that they might be yoked to Christ just as you are and that we all might continue the work we have here in our life of sanctification. Yes, dear fellow redeemed, life will continue to make us tired. Those mornings are still going to come early. The days are still going to be long. We're still going to get spiritually fatigued occasionally. But when that happens, we can always point back to these words. We can always be reminded that Christ is still yoked to us. He's not going to leave us. And he loves us. He loves us so much. And he has given us the promise of true rest even now, until we shut our eyes for the final time and wake up fully refreshed in heaven. Until that day, let us continually return to the cross and return to the promises of Christ for rest when we need it. Dear fellow redeemed, amen. We will now continue with the confession of faith according to the Nicene Creed. Please stand. We believe
in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Almighty God and Father, we thank you for all your mercies, especially for the gift of your Son, through whom you have revealed your gracious will. We praise you for the Holy Spirit and his working through the means of grace.
Plant your word in our hearts and cause it to produce fruit in our lives.
Strengthen and defend your church, that by your word and sacraments faith may grow and love toward all may increase.
Support all who spread the light of your truth throughout the world.
Keep our children in the grace of their baptisms. Enable their parents to train them in the lives of faith.
Raise up Christians to serve you in the ministry of the word and in all godly walks of life.
Preserve our nation in justice and honor. Guide and bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws.
Give them wisdom that they may promote justice and hinder evil.
Let your blessing rest on planting and harvest, commerce and industry, medicine and science, the arts and culture. Protect all who travel and care for those who work, whose work is difficult or dangerous.
Be with all who devote themselves to any useful task.
Comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those whom death draws near.
Grant them your love and take them into your tender care.
Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. Remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you, who now rest from their labors. Console those who are mourning or living with sadness.
Keep us in the true faith and bring us at last to the joys of heaven.
Grant us these things, Father, for the sake of Jesus, who died and rose again.
Amen.
Lord, as your prospering hand has blessed, may we give you of our best, and by deeds of kindly love, for your mercy's grateful fruit. Singing thus through all our days, praise to God, immortal praise. Amen. Please stand. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song.
Blessed is he, blessed is he.
your dear Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent to be our Savior, our Redeemer, and the messenger of your grace. Through him you made all things. In him you are well pleased. He is the incarnate Word, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. To fulfill your promises, he stretched out his hands on the cross and released from eternal death all who believe in you. As we remember Jesus' death and resurrection, we thank you that you have gathered us together to receive your Son's body and blood. Send us your Spirit, unite us as one, and strengthen our faith so that we may praise you in your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we glorify and honor you, O God our Father, with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Mercy on us.
Please stand. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
You may be seated for our closing hymn.
Thank you. Wells President Mark Schrader. Just a few weeks ago, more than 400 delegates met in Saginaw, Michigan for our Synod's 67th Biennial Convention. The goal was to celebrate God's blessings on our past ministry and, importantly, to set in motion our church body's plans for the future.
Brothers, I hereby declare that this convention of the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod is now in session.
The theme for this convention, Embrace the Cross, Anticipate the Crown, reminds us of our most precious blessing and our most important message as a church body.
We preach Christ crucified. We deliver the goods via word and sacrament. Let's die to all of it, to anyone and anything other than Christ crucified. There he saves. There he promises to us a crown.
Just share a brief summary about where these new starts were approved.
2023 is the first year of our Synod's ambitious initiative to start 100 new home missions and enhance the mission endeavors of 75 other churches during the next 10 years. 9 of the new home missions have already been approved. 1 more will be approved this fall.
Those people who are lost aren't raising their hands and they're not saying, send a pastor to us, send a pastor to me, I don't know the gospel, I want you to tell me about the gospel. And so there's this balance that we recognize, that we want those who are being served with the gospel to continue to be served with the gospel. But equally important is the importance of those who don't know the gospel and don't know Jesus.
Our Synod's ministry financial plan, approved by the delegates and supported by generous congregation mission offerings and special gifts, provides resources to maintain and grow the exciting opportunities we have to share Christ's love through our areas of ministry during the next 2 years.
The Lord has blessed us immensely with gifts, and it's good to see that and to see the reports given and what they contain.
A high point of the convention was the declaration of fellowship with the Obadiah Lutheran Synod in Uganda.
Fellowship is a great blessing from our Lord and something he wants to give us.
And the affirmation of fellowship with a church body in Latin America called Iglesia Cristo Wells Internacional.
Lo único que pasa por mi corazón y por mi cabeza es mucha alegría. De saber que vamos a trabajar juntos en el reino de Dios. Es lo que vamos a hacer nosotros en armonía, llevar el mensaje de salvación, las buenas noticias de salvación a otra gente que no conoce de esa buena noticia que Cristo nos dio.
I have to bring you news, joyful news, that long prayed for and supported work by Wells in Vietnam has seen a huge milestone.
World Missions updated delegates on exciting news from Vietnam regarding the recent dedication of our new Theological Education Center for leaders of the Hmong Fellowship Church.
Bigger than the building, throughout this time that we have been navigating through the difficult red tape of the Vietnamese government over about 4 years of this project, the whole time they have allowed us to train our first cohort of pastors. And just this last month, the first 55 pastors of the Hmong Fellowship Church graduated.
Another important order of business was the election of synodical leaders. Second Vice President Pastor Joel Voss was re-elected, and President Mark Schrader was re-elected to his 5th term. He has been faithfully serving as Synod President for 16 years.
I humbly accept your call as Synod President. And I do so with the prayer that God would continue to work in you as members of our Synod through his powerful word, working a stronger faith and continuing to work in you the zeal to carry the message of the gospel to people around the world.
The convention was held at Michigan Lutheran Seminary, one of our Synod's 2 prep schools, which helps prepare high school students to serve as pastors, teachers, and staff ministers. One of the biggest opportunities our church body has is to encourage and train men and women to serve as Christ's ambassadors.
The need for called workers is certainly great, and so as the Lord gives us opportunities to reach more and more, certainly we want more teachers, staff ministers, pastors, to encourage those people in their lives of faith.
Being able to contribute, participate, and understand really what goes into running of a church body, all the different parts that make up the whole, all of the intricate decision making that has to go on and make the church run to God's glory the way it does.
For more details on all the events of the convention, as well as the gospel ministries you support with your congregation mission offerings, visit the Synod Convention website at wellsconvention.net.